Grace and peace be multiplied to you through the knowledge of God and our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome. Today we'll be looking at God sending Christ to man. God sending Christ to man. What a joy, what a joy, what a joy. Grace and peace be multiplied to you through the knowledge of God and our Lord Jesus Christ. The knowledge of God and Jesus is the sweetest thing under heavens. He prayed in John 17 that this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus whom you have sent. So the heart is always rejoicing each time the knowledge, the news of Christ comes into it. So man's greatest need is God, and I think that is indisputable, that every man realizes that they are not sufficient in themselves, that our greatest need in life is not food, it's not water. We need those things to live here on earth. It's not oxygen. We need it to breathe. But our greatest need in life is God, because God, all those things, food, water, air, and what have you, clothing, they are just types and shadows of preaching that the real food in life is actually God in Christ. So God is the greatest need of man. And God created man that way. And his only means to reach man is Christ, because Christ is the way to God. Christ is the means of God. Christ is the channel God will use to do anything with man. Someone will say, why would Christ be? God dwells in unapproachable light. How will a fallen man be able to relate with the God that dwells in unapproachable light? He has to come in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. What a joy for what the Lord is doing in our life. Everything God will give man is through Christ. Everything that God will give man is going to be through Christ. Whether it's the mercy of God, the love of God, the salvation of God, the power, the wisdom, everything coming from God is going to go through Christ. And God is the one sending Christ to man. And let's not think that Christ is distant from God. He said, I and the Father are one. So the coming of Christ to man is actually the coming of God to man. And so when God is sending Christ, God is actually sending himself to man. Why do we say this? Because God is embodied in Christ. Christ is the embodiment of the fullness of the Godhead dwells in Christ. Is the embodiment of the Godhead. So when God is sending Christ to man, actually that is God coming himself. And we saw this, he said this in the Gospel of John, most of it, more than in any other part, that I am not alone, the Father is with me. So it's not just the one third of him that came on in his earthly ministry, but the full Godhead, the Father, the Son, the Spirit, embodied in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. So when God is coming to us, he's sending Christ, but God is not distinct from Christ. God is not, they are inseparable. You can say they are distinct because of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, but it's still the same one true God. So when Christ is coming, that is actually God coming. So Christ is God coming to man. 1 Timothy 3:15 says, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifested in the flesh. The word becoming flesh is the Lord Jesus Christ. But the scripture said God was manifested in the flesh. So Christ is the God coming to us, because God is embodied in Christ. God is embodied in Christ. So I don't think we can ever separate the Father from the Son. Wherever the Son is, the Father is there. Wherever the Father is, the Son is there. It's a very mysterious union. And what a joy that Christ is God coming to man. And in John chapter 17, this is why we see the fact that in many of the salutations in each epistle, to be grace and peace from God our Father and Lord Jesus Christ. The church of God is the church of Christ. The kingdom of God is the kingdom of Christ. So, and in prayer of John 17, which is the greatest prayer by many, we believe, in the Bible, when the Lord was praying for certain things to be done after he's gone. This was before his crucifixion. And he said, this is eternal life, and or life eternal from some translation, that they may know you, the only true God, and Christ Jesus Christ whom you have sent. So God himself in Christ, Christ is praying that we will know him. That was actually, I think, his first prayer, his first or second prayer, that they may know the only true God and Jesus Christ whom he has been sent to us. So we need to be aware that Christ has been sent to us, that Christ is the one sent to us from God. He said this repeatedly, I don't know, maybe 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 times. He said in the Gospel of John alone that I am sent to you. And we go through some of those scriptures, that I'm sent to you, and that is the good shepherd, and also the true vine mentioning. So Jesus answered and said to them, this is the work of God, this is in John chapter 6, that you believe in him whom he sent. He kept on repeating it, but you do not believe in him that God has sent to you. And he kept on saying it because it was re-emphasizing it. And look, God wants to send himself to you, but you don't expect to see God in himself, because God is in me and God has sent me. That is the Lord Jesus Christ. Now to the the Lord Jesus Christ before them. So he said, this is the work of God. They were thinking that God was going to give them something supernatural, you know, spectacular. All of a sudden, he said that, look, just believe in the one God has sent. And he said in Romans, and he said, how shall they believe in whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without being sent? I mean, Romans 10, that the Lord is rich to all that call upon him. So before we call upon him, we can't call upon him except we've heard about him. We can't believe him except we've heard about him. And the tree of life is God sending Christ to man. So we want to go through some of the things or some of the illustrations the Lord used in the Word of God regarding Christ as the one being sent. So first, the first type that we could say hit us in the Bible is the tree of life in Genesis chapter 2. And that is God sending Christ to man, because God wanted the substance of man to actually be Christ. That is the food of man. Man is a vessel of God, is created in the image of God, and the image of God from Colossians 1 is just Christ himself. So the content of man is supposed to be Christ. So God puts the tree of life before man so that man could eat of that. He disobeyed, and long story short, the Lord had to come himself. That's why I said, I'm the bread of life, I'm the true vine. The tabernacle as well, which God had actually instructed Moses when they were in the wilderness on the way to the promised land, it's just a type of Christ, God sending Christ to man. Why do we say God, Christ is the tabernacle of God? The tabernacle is just the dwelling place of God. Basically, it's the dwelling place of God among his people. And God dwells in no other house than in Christ. And we see the reality of this in John 2, 21, when he said that they bring down the temple and in 3 days I will raise it. So God gave them the tabernacle, which was a type of God sending Christ to man. Of course, we get to John 1 and said, and that the Word became flesh and we beheld his glory, and the Word tabernacled, became flesh and tabernacled among us. The Word of God is God sending Christ to man. So when we are studying the Word of God, when we are praying for God to send us his Rhema word, essentially God is sending Christ to us. So God gives us a lot of things, sends a lot of things to us. Let's not think those things are things that distinct from Christ. And that's why the Lord said in John chapter 5 that you search the scripture. I was telling the Sadducees and the Pharisees, you search the scripture, for you think you have eternal life there, but you will not come to me that you may have life. That the scriptures actually were testifying on him. So the Word of God is just God sending Christ to man, who is the seed of the Word as well. The prophets, as God sent, were prefiguring Christ. You know, the prophets were the mouthpiece of God. God usually will send prophets to his people who will speak the mind, the will of God. So then his nation Israel, most of it that we saw in the Old Testament, but they were all prefiguring Christ. When Christ came, Hebrews 1 said God spoke to our fathers by the prophet, but this day is speaking to us in the Son, because God is in the Son. So they were prefiguring Christ as well as the sent one to us from God. God sending Christ as the grace of God. So God wants his grace. Man needs the grace of God. God sent Christ to us, who is the embodiment of the grace of God. He is the grace of God that has appeared to all men and bringeth salvation. What a joy. Also, God sent Christ in the flesh to redeem man. So we're looking at maybe from scriptures about
sent Christ to us in the flesh to redeem man. And so he was sent to us in different dimensions, and
we needed him in different aspects. We needed the wisdom of God, and Christ is the wisdom of God. We needed redemption. We needed the power of God. We needed the mercy of God. And God has sent him to us, and that's what I mean by different dimensions, because our needs are, they are so numerous, and Christ is the one that means. So he was sent to us, Galatians 4:4 tells us, born of a woman, that God sent him in the flesh to us to redeem man for redemption, because man sinned and man needed to be redeemed back to God. And he came as the last Adam to redeem man. So God sending Christ as a life-giving spirit to indwell us. So God did not just send him in the flesh, but upon his resurrection, 1 Corinthians 15:45, it says, the last Adam became a life-giving spirit. So God also sent him, the spirit of his Son, Galatians 4:6, as well, so into our heart, crying, Abba, Father. So in the flesh for redemption, as the spirit to indwell us and to transform us. And today, like Romans 8 says, if any has not the spirit of Christ, is none of his. So God sending Christ as well as a bread of life that nourishes man. We need nourishment spiritually. And of course, the only person that meets that description is the Lord Jesus Christ. So God wants to be our food, and is our food in the Lord Jesus, because Christ is the bread of God, the bread from heaven, the bread of God, the living bread as well, the true food, so that he could nourish us with the bread of life, because
God's goal is to dispense himself into us. And how will he do that? It is through the person of Christ. God sending Christ as a true vine for man to be grafted into. So you can see, I mean, the riches of Christ are unsearchable. His person is unsearchable. So this is him. There's the Christ as the bread of life. There's Christ as the true vine. There's Christ as the shepherd. I mean, different things that he is the shepherd of our soul. So as a true vine, what's God's goal for sending Christ to us as a true vine? So that we can be grafted into him. We were branches of Adam by the fall of man. Now God has taken us out of Adam and put us, grafted us into Christ, so that we could be grafted into divinity. And that's what part of the reason God sent him as a true vine. God sent Christ to us as a true light in John chapter 1 as well. This is the light, the true light that gives light to every man, that gives light to every man. So in him was life, and the life was the light of men, and the light shineth in darkness, and darkness cannot comprehend it. And he's the light of the world. So you can see that God sending Christ to us as the light of God as well, so that our life will be a light to the world. God sending Christ as his glory in man, and or his glory upon man, whichever preposition you want to use there. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Glory is the manifestation of God. They said that glorify me, and that John 17 and the prayer, and the Father said, I have glorified it and I've glorified it again. So we can see that God is sending Christ so that he could be made manifest in our life. What a joy, what a joy. God sending Christ to us as the bishop, the overseer, the shepherd of our soul. After, upon salvation, we still need a shepherd. We needed a shepherd over our soul. Our spirit has been regenerated by the Lord as the life-giving spirit. And yet our soul, which is the second part of us, we're a spirit, we have a soul, we live in a body. That soul needs a shepherd and overseer. And no one can do this except Christ. 1 Peter 2:25, the shepherd of our soul, the bishop of our soul. Our soul is the center of our being, our emotions, the will, I mean, the mind is just centered in the soul. Man needs a ransom. So man needs a ransom. God is aware about that because of the fall, the miscue of the first man. God sends Christ as the ransom for man. 1 Timothy chapter 2 is the ransom for man. It's also the ransom for all. I think Mark 10:45 is the ransom for man. Man needs a deliverer, and no other person could do it except the Lamb that was slain from the foundation of the world. God sent Christ. So whatever man needs that will be a blessing to him, it is just embodied in Christ. God has embodied everything man would need in Christ. Man wants God's kingdom. We desire God's kingdom. Anybody in their right think of their right thinking, we desire a better kingdom than the kingdom of man. And now we wanted the kingdom that is above all kingdom. God sent Christ, because the coming of Christ, especially in the Gospels, was the coming of the kingdom of God. That's why I said the kingdom of God is among you. He is the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is embodied in him. Man wants needs God's righteousness. We don't want our righteousness. Our righteousness is filthy rags. It's not acceptable before God. God has to send Christ to us. He made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, so that we can become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. So you can see that we need God's righteousness. We need God's holiness. We need God's mercy. And God is always going to send Christ to us. And this is not just a one-time thing that, okay, when we give our life, every day we are living in the consciousness that God is my true vine. I'm going out to day and I'm going that, Lord, you are my bread of life. Thank you for feeding me with the bread of life. You are my light. You are the true light. Let my life be a light. That this is where prayer points and thanksgiving ritually comes from, because we are reading the scriptures and we are saying, this is what God has sent to me in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, and it becomes our living reality. Man wants peace. Romans chapter 5 verse 1, therefore we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. We want peace. We don't want to be at war with God, and our peace with God is only secured through the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Man wants God's life. Who doesn't want God? I don't want the human life alone in me. I want the divine life as well to be the one actually manifesting through me. We want God's life. God says, God, my life is in no other person than in the Lord Jesus Christ. I have come that they may have life. He is the resurrection and the life. The resurrected life of God himself is just in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. So whatever we need in life, whatever we want in life that will add value to us, we come to God in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and pray that he opens our eyes of understanding to see that Christ is the very provision and the reality of what we are asking for. Whether it is peace, whether it is breakthrough, whether it is the joy, fellowship with God, it is always going to be Christ that God is going to send to us. Man needs a perfect offering to present before God. We need to present offering. I'm not talking of money offerings. I mean, Thank God for those. I'm going beyond that to the fact that we're presenting ourselves, our life as a living sacrifice before the Lord. Our heart especially. God has your heart. He has every other thing you will have. So I'm more interested in the part that we need an offering to present to God. And that's why God says that in 1 Peter chapter 2 as well, that all our spiritual sacrifices are acceptable because of Christ. That we offer the sacrifice of praise to God, the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to Him through the Lord Jesus Christ. So we need a perfect offering, because it's the reality of the sin offering, the burnt offering, the wave offering, the trespass, all the offerings in the Old Testament were pointing to Christ. And the perfect one without blemish is just Christ. So we come to God and present that offering to God in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. What a joy. Man also wants God's wisdom. How will he get God's wisdom? It is Christ, because Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. He has made Christ to be his wisdom for us. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, because it is of God, we are in Christ Jesus, who is made unto us wisdom from God. So I need the wisdom of God. Someone defined wisdom in this way, that wisdom is essentially what God will do in any situation, what God, the decision, the step God will take in any circumstance. And you and I, we are always in certain situation, whether we're making a business decision, parenting decision, a position in our jobs, and different thing in ministry. And the wisdom to get that is the Lord Jesus Christ. So when we are asking for the growth in the knowledge of God, in the knowledge of Christ, in the person of Christ, when Christ is being formed in us, the wisdom of God is actually being made manifest. Man desires God's spirit. We just don't want our own human spirit. How are we going to get man's spirit? God's spirit, God sends Christ. He's the one that baptizes us with the Holy Spirit. He's the one that comes as a life-giving spirit to give life to every part of our body. So we need the spirit of God. We desire it. We just don't want the human spirit. Now we've been made one spirit with God in Christ Jesus. Man wants an indwelling savior. I don't want a remote savior alone. I'm sure for a lot of Christian believers and a lot of Christians, if not everyone, we want God to be domiciled in us, to be resident in us. We want an indwelling savior, not just a remote savior in the heavens, in the sitting on the throne alone. We want him to be in our hearts. And God is saying that, look, Ephesians 3, that Christ making his home in our hearts. So God sent Christ as the indwelling savior in our life. Also, man desires a covenant with God. Yeah, we desire it, because the covenant with God is an everlasting covenant which he did for us in Christ. God sent Christ. He's the one that consummated the new covenant and the everlasting covenant that we have in Christ Jesus with God. So we need a covenant. Everyone that will ever fulfill their destiny in life, they need a covenant, because the covenant actually oversees their affairs in the realm of the spirit. It makes certain things happen in their life that would not otherwise have happened, things that would benefit them, because it's an invisible spirit. When I mean invisible spirit, there's an invisible law. I think I rather prefer that, an invisible law in the realm of the spirit that is just making sure a person succeeds in life. We need a covenant with God, and that covenant, God has sent Christ, who consummated that covenant in his blood. Man needs a high priest. God sent Christ. What is a high priest coming to do? As the Son of God, he imparts us with the life of God. As our high priest, he now facilitates our, brings us in fellowship with God. He brings us in fellowship with the divine. So we are able to come into the presence of God, because it's our high priest who is ministering God into us, who is taking care, nourishing us. Oh, what a joy that we have fellowship with the Son and the Father and the Spirit in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. What a joy. Man needs a word from God. Don't you need a word? I need a word from God every now and then. I need to hear from God continuously and constantly, because I'm living in this life. Because a word from God is a word of direction, a word of guidance, the safety in what God says. I don't know what tomorrow will look like. I know it will be well with me, because the scripture says so. It will be well with you as a redeemed of the law. But sometimes we need certain specifics so that we don't waste our time, energy, and resources just doing what we were not called to do. We need a word from God, and God sent Christ, who is the word of God to us. What a joy. Man needs healing. And who else is the best healer? It's the great physician himself. By his stripes we are healed. So man needs healing, and God sent Christ to man. So we can see, whatever we need in life, it is God, it is Christ that God will always send to us. Things that will add value to our life, that will be a blessing to humanity, is the great physician. It is his blood that cleanses us from all sin. Man needs a head. I need a head over my life. When I mean head, I'm not just talking physical head, spiritually. I need a head, because from the head flows the oil. From the head flows nourishment. I mean, your head speaks. You see from your head, the eyes, the ear gate, and your head, the brain is in the head. The control center is from the head. And the speaking power as well of man is in the head. So I need a head. And this, and the health, if a health is healthy, the body will be healthy. The body just takes the shape after the quality of the head. The quality of the head or needs is the body also. As not, this is not just an inorganic head. This is an organic head. That the wisdom in the head flows to the body. So you can see that we needed the right head. That's why Christ has been given to us as the head of the church. God sent Christ to us. What a joy. Man wants to be a particle of the divine nature. How are we going to be a particle of the divine nature? God sent Christ. So you can see the list of things we need are endless, because we are empty without God. That's why I said that abide in me and I in you, for without me you can do nothing. So we need to be, we want to be a particle of the divine nature, the mercy of God, the love of God, the power of God, the wisdom of God, the divine nature of God. And now Christ is the means that connects us to the divine nature of God. Man wants to know God. God sent Christ. He said in Matthew 11:28-27 that no one knows the Father, no one knows the Son except the Father, no one knows the Father except the Son, and it's the one that the Son has chosen to reveal it to. We need to know God, because the knowledge of God brings confidence. The knowledge of God actually, God says, let anyone that boasts, let him boast that he knows me, from Jeremiah. I need to know God. Without Christ, God will be unknowable to man. God will be hidden to man. I need to know God, and you need to know. Our knowledge base has to increase in God. That's why a lot of the prayers are so that we increase in the knowledge of God. And God sent Christ to us, who is the Word of God, to reveal God, to define, because Christ is the definition of God. Christ is the definition of God, is the manifestation of God, is the expression of God, is the unveiling of God, the revelation of God is Christ, because God is embodied and domiciled in Christ. Man wants to dwell in God. I want God to be an eternal abode for me. I want to live in God. How will I live in God? God sent Christ, because Christ is the dwelling place of God. I am in the Father, and the Father is in me. He is the reality of the temple of God. And so God is living in Christ, and Christ is living in God. And so I want to live in God. I don't know about you. I want my address in life to be God. That's what he was actually telling the disciples in John chapter 14, that where I am, that you may be also. He was going to the Father. So he wanted us to, he wants to make his Father our abode. And today we are living testimonies of that. So we want to dwell in God, and God sent Christ to us, that Christ is the way into the Father. Man wants to feed on God. I just don't want to eat natural foods alone. I want to eat the Word of life, the bread of life, the Spirit of life. I want to drink the water of life. And how will I do that? God sent Christ as the bread of life, as the water of life, as the Spirit of life, as the Word of life, as the author of life, as the light of life, as the reality of the tree of life. So God sent Christ to us so that we can feed on him. And this was a lot. He said in this in John chapter 6, that my body is the true food and my blood is the true drink, that I am the living bread. I am the bread that comes from heaven. As the living Father sent me, and I live by the Father, so whoever eats me shall live by me. So I want to feed on God continually. Man desires to have God as his Father. I don't know about you, but it's the longing of any right thinking man. They just don't want to have it, because our earthly fathers are limited. They are just humans like us. They can't be everywhere, and they don't have every resource or power to be able to carry out their good pleasure in our life. They will try as much as they can, but having God as our Father is a game changer any day, because as our Father, he becomes our very life. And it's not just a distant Father, but an indwelling Father. He's the God that is all powerful. I mean, our earthly parents here, as wonderful as their good intentions might be, let's say you're writing an exam, they can't come to assist you in the exam, but our earthly Father, because he's everywhere, he can assist us in every form, in every fashion. So we needed God to be our Father. That was why, maybe upon his resurrection, one of the early things he said, especially to Mary, to the disciples, was that I'm going to my Father and your Father, my God and your God. Man wants God to be his eternal abode. God sent Christ. So I want God to be my eternal abode. I just don't want God to be my abode here on earth, but also in eternity as well. I want God to be my eternal abode. How will God be my eternal abode? God sent Christ. That as I am in Christ, I am actually in God as well. To be in Christ is to be in God. For Christ to be in me is for God to be in me, because God is embodied in Christ. What a joy that God, man wants God to be his eternal abode, and God sent it. So God is delighted to doing this. That's why in Galatians chapter 1, Paul was saying that when he pleased God to who separated me from my mother's womb to reveal his son in me. God is excited, he's pleased to reveal more of his son, the saints want to rule. Man wants to be a son of God, God sent Christ. How are we going to be sons? We just don't want to be sons of men. Sons of God means that we came forth from God, we proceeded from God. God gave birth to us, we experienced a new birth, the regeneration, and we were reborn by God, because the life of God is now in us, not just adopted, but the life of God. Adopted children don't have the life of their parents, of their foster parent, but the biological son naturally has the life of their parent, and God has given birth to us in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. So today we are now sons of God through the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, because God wants many sons, and God is still looking for many sons. Sons here connotes male and female, because in the new creation there is no male or female, we are just sons of God. What a joy. Man also wants God to dwell in him. So man wants to dwell in God, he also wants God to dwell in him. What a joy. And God, that's God's intention, that I in you and you in me, you in and abide in me and I in you. A coherence union, we might want to call it, that we are dwelling in God and God is dwelling in us. 1 John 4:15 says that whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God, God dwells in him and he in God. So we want God to dwell in us. God sends Christ, that Christ is the medium, the channel of God coming into our life, of God becoming our food, of God becoming our drink, God becoming our power, our mercy, our strength. Christ is the channel of everything that God will do. Man wants fellowship with God. God said, there's no way you can have fellowship with me. I dwell in unapproachable light. There's only one medium. It is through Christ. Not really a medium. There's only one way. That is through the very person of the Lord Jesus Christ. So our fellowship is with the Father and with the Son. So we want to relate with God. We want to commune with God. And there's no other. It's a privilege. If someone says, for example, in the nation you are in, they have time, the president of that land spends quality time with them every week or so, they have access to the room of the president, wherever in the presidential villa, White House, or wherever you are in any parts of the world, I mean, you consider that person a privileged person. Now imagine the us as, and God says, and Christ is the means whereby we have boldness and confidence to come into the presence of the Father to fellowship with God. What a joy. Man wants union with God. Man wants union with God. God sent Christ. After being in union with me, it is through Christ Jesus, because he is in Christ Jesus. He and the Father, they are one. So everything again. So this is what gives us confidence. This is what births praises and thanksgiving from our hearts. And we are making melody to the Lord for what God has done for us in Christ Jesus. This is why every thanksgiving, every praise is going through Christ. Appreciating God for the person of Christ and his works that he has done for us. Man wants to spend eternity with God. God sent Christ, that there's no way you can spend eternity with God without Christ. If I could read maybe from 1 Corinthians chapter 1, I think verse 8, that God is faithful. That verse 9 is that God is faithful, who has called you into fellowship with his Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. That means we are actually called into fellowship with Christ. But the part I'm looking for is 1 Corinthians 1, I think verse 8. And talks in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 verse 8 says that we shall also confirm you unto the end, that you may be blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. So that we are one with the Lord and we are spending eternity with God because of our union with Christ and walking faithfully with him to the end. Man wants power over darkness. Say, for this reason the Son of God was made manifested, that he might destroy the works of Satan. How are we going to destroy the works of Satan without the light of God in us? So God sends Christ to us as his light, as his power, as his wisdom. That will give you a mountain of wisdom which none of your enemies will be able to gainsay or resist. So, but you, this is John chapter 5 verse 38. But you do not have his word. This was him, to the Lord saying to the Pharisees. But you do not have his word abiding in you, because whom he sent, him you do not believe. So God wants us to believe that Christ is the sent one to us. So in any situation you are in and in, God wants us to be conscious of the fact that Christ is the sent one. For that matter, we'll stop looking elsewhere. We are looking unto the Lord. That's why the scripture says, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. We are beholding the Lord. That's as we behold him as in a glass in a mirror, we are being transformed from glory to glory. So we keep beholding the Lord. It is our beholding the Lord that actually the Lord is able to minister into whatever need we are looking at. So, and the Pharisees said, you do not have his word abide. So the word of God abiding in us is Christ pretty much abiding in us as well. It said this in John chapter 15. And this is John 7:29. but I know him, for I am from him, and he sent me. He was telling them, God sent me. God is the one that has sent me to you, but you don't want to believe in me. You don't want to believe in the one that God has sent. So how are you going to be saved? So you can see that every day we want to live in the consciousness that God has sent Christ to me. So whether it is in the place of prayer, Christ is the one sent to me because I pray in his name. Whether it's a place of studying the scripture, I come to him. He's the reality, he's the living, because the letter killer, the spirit gives life. He's the one that gives life from his scripture. So you can see that he is the sent one to us from God. What a joy. Without Christ, God cannot reach man, and man cannot reach God. Let's settle that there. Without Christ, how will the God that dwell in unapproachable light? Every man will just be dying that attempts to reach God without Christ, because he dwells in unapproachable light. But Christ is the medium, God manifested in the flesh, that where God became contactable, reachable, knowable through the very person of the Lord Jesus Christ. What a joy, what a joy. I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the way, the reality. The truth is not just doctrinal, the reality. That is the reality of anything we are desiring from God that will be a blessing to humanity. Is the reality of the sun, is the reality of the food we eat, the water we drink, is the reality. Is him. They are just shadows. And the life as well. So he is the way. What a joy, what a joy. So today we've been able to look at God sending Christ to man, and we said that man's greatest need is God, and God's only means of reaching man is Christ, who is the way as well. God sent the prophets in the Old Testament to man, and of course they were all prefiguring Christ in the assignments and in the offices in which they occupy. The tree of life is God sending Christ to man. The tabernacle is God sending Christ to man, because the tabernacle is the dwelling place of God. The tree of life, we could say, is a food for man to sustain man. Also, God sending Christ in different dimension and different ways to us. The wisdom of God is Christ. The word of God is Christ. God cried, man wants the kingdom of God, and God sends Christ. Man wants peace with God, God sends Christ. Man wants the love of God to be in his heart, God sends Christ. Man wants the mercy of God, God sends Christ. Man wants to be a God, God sent Christ. Man wants God to be his eternal dwelling place, his eternal abode, God sent Christ. So everything that we need in life is always going to come from God, who we sent Christ to us, who is the true vine, God sending him as a true vine so that we can be grafted into him. God sending him as a bread of life so that we can be nourished by him. God sending him as the great physician as well, so that if there is anyone sick among us, they can be healed. So whatever need, whatever situation we're going through in life, Christ is the way. God sending Christ is God sending himself to us. So let's not think that Christ coming to us is separate from God. That is him, one with the Godhead. He's even actually even called the Everlasting Father. Isaiah 9:6, that unto us a child is born, a son is given, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. Whether it is peace, we know Christ is the one, because God is embodied in Christ. So Christ coming to us is the coming of God to us. That's why I said, I am not alone, the Father is in me. And that was Christ in the flesh. Christ in the flesh came so that he could redeem us. Christ came as a life-giving spirit so that he could transform us and he can indwell us. So today, the joy is that God has sent his only begotten Son to us. And God, Christ has come to us, who is the life of God, who is the wisdom of God, who is the power of God, who is the embodiment of the Godhead. There is no need we ever need in life that will be a blessing to humanity, that will make us a value-adding person in the world, that Christ is not the reality. It's the true light that lights every man that comes to this world. What a joy for the gift that God has given to us. Hallelujah to the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. God sending Christ to man. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.